For the ones who work hard to ensure their crew can always go the extra mile, and the ones who get in early so everyone can go home on time, there's Grainger, offering professional-grade supplies backed by product experts so you can quickly and easily find what you need. Plus, you can count on access to a committed team ready to go the extra mile for you. Call, click Grainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
Dick. Without the ones like you, who work tirelessly to keep things running, everything would suddenly stop. Hospitals, factories, schools, and power plants, they all depend on you. No matter the weather, emergency, or time of day, you're the ones who get it done. At Grainger, we're here for you with professional-grade industrial supplies. Count on real-time product availability and fast delivery. Call, click Grainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
WBSM presents The Tim Meisberg Show, streaming live on WBSM.com and the WBSM app. Call 508-996-0500. Send us app chat messages and open line voicemails using the WBSM app. Now, The Tim Meisberg Show.
Welcome back in hour number two of the program here on Friday morning. And we were talking in the first hour about eclipse plans coming up on Monday. We will have a total solar eclipse, although we'll get about 90% totality here, which will make it'll darken a little bit, but it's not going to be as dark as if you were in the path of totality, 100% totality. But it's still going to be weird, and it's still going to be something that you're going to want to see, and it's still something that kids are going to want to see. Some schools, like Warwick Public Schools, are doing things the right way and dismissing kids early. They're saying, you know what, we can't guarantee that kids are going to all be wearing eclipse viewers and be safe, and we have one teacher for 30 kids, and that's too many for one teacher to keep an eye on, especially when the teacher is probably going to be looking up at the sky too. So we've got to let these kids out early. Plus, it's going to get darker out, and people might not be paying attention on the roads. They might be looking up in the sky when they're driving, and we've got kids that walk home from school. So in order to avoid all of these potential problems, we're just going to dismiss kids early. And some parents are outraged by that. Some parents cannot believe that the schools would send kids home early for that. These same parents who probably, you know, if there's 2 inches of snow on the ground and the school says, oh, we still have school. No, the snow fell overnight. We've had plenty of time to come out and, you know, shovel the walks and clear everything. No, we still have school. What do you mean you have school? Oh, you have to keep the kids home. You can't make them go to school in this. These are the same parents that are saying, I can't believe you're sending my child home for an eclipse. So, by the way, I don't think they actually sound like that. That's what we call, you know, dramatic effect, dramatic license. But that's my pearl clutching voice. But these parents are outraged by this when the school laid out the reasoning why. Now, the other part of that is how many of those kids are going home to an empty house because their parent has to work. Their parent doesn't get to leave work early because of the eclipse. Now, your kid is going to be home looking at the eclipse, and you don't know if they're going to be using protective eyewear to look at the sun. So, I get it. It's a sticky situation, but I think the right move is sending the kids home early because they're going to be so distracted by it. I think what DR is trying to do is not fair. Dighton Rehoboth said, no, we're not letting kids go outside and look at this. We can't guarantee their eye safety. So you know what? We're all just staying in the classroom. That's just not fair. That's like if Taylor Swift showed up at your school, pulled up outside your school in a limousine, and all the other classes went outside to go watch her perform a song on the front lawn of your school. And your teacher was like, no, we've got to get through chapter 14. No, you're not going outside. We are going to read chapter 14. The whole world is outside experiencing something really fun, really cool. I won't say once in a lifetime, but certainly a rare, rare, rare occurrence. And you're stuck in the classroom. I can just imagine how unhappy those kids are with that. 508-996-0500. Of course, we don't just have to talk about the eclipse. We can talk about whatever's on your mind, but I just, you know, this is really irking me this morning, so I thought that I would bring it up to you. So one of the things that I mentioned, I think yesterday I brought it up, is this is WrestleMania weekend, and I still encourage you, if you haven't read it already, check out my story on local pro wrestler and shop owner Teddy Goods, who made an appearance on SmackDown last Friday, which you can see at WBSM.com and on the app. But the other part of it is this is the biggest weekend for WWE fans. This is a holiday weekend for WWE fans. WrestleMania weekend is a big deal. And so with that in mind, this is the one day where we definitely will allow wrestling talk here on the program. If anybody does want to call in with their WrestleMania predictions, I will take those. Because this is shaping up to be a pretty fun event. There's a lot of matches that just seem thrown together to fill up two nights worth of action. There's a lot of, and I'm looking at the card and I'm like, do they even have enough matches for two nights? There's going to be a lot of stuff that gets like announced tonight or even the day of, which is not the best way to do it. But they've got enough feuds going into this that I'm interested. And you can call in with your thoughts on some of those. But also yesterday we talked about the school resource officer at Cambridge Ridge and Latin, who was using the staff bathroom and his gun went off while he was removing it to use the bathroom. And that this, as we've learned, this was not the first time that one of these Sig Sauer P320s had gone off on its own within the Cambridge Police Department. They'd had four incidents since 2019, including one time in a van full of officers where luckily nobody was hurt. But that there's actually active lawsuits against Sig Sauer for this model going off on its own. And there's a story out of Newburyport, WCVB has it this morning. A New Hampshire man is heading to court a week after a gun went off inside of a brewery and a child was grazed by shrapnel. The charges allege that the customer at the center of this case should not have been carrying a gun in Massachusetts in the first place. He was one of three people injured when the weapon discharged, and today he's going to be arraigned in Newburyport. So it says he accidentally discharged a gun last Friday in the dining area of True North Ale Company in Ipswich. He required treatment at the hospital for his wound. Two other people were injured by shrapnel, including a juvenile who also had to go to the hospital. The brewery owners posted on social media saying the customer who, quote, discharged his concealed handgun had, quote, no malicious intent. And the statement from them goes on to read, we are licensed gun owners ourselves, yet we must insist that a place like our taproom is not a place for firearms. Well, yeah, no place that serves alcohol is a place for firearms. You're not supposed to carry a firearm on you in Massachusetts if you've been drinking. Or if you plan on drinking. Also, this guy was from New Hampshire and had this gun on him after he crossed state lines. I'm going to assume that this brewery is a brewery slash restaurant type place because it says dining area, and that it's okay for juveniles to be in there. Some tap rooms, some breweries do not allow you to bring kids in. They have to be 21 plus. But it sounds like this was not one of those types of places. But this guy, whose name is Donald Terenzoni, he's going to be arraigned today on charges that include carrying a loaded firearm without a license, discharging a firearm within 500 feet of a building, and three counts of assault and battery with a dangerous weapon. So the carrying a firearm without a license charge, I'm going to guess he's probably a licensed gun owner in New Hampshire, but that charge comes into play because you are not a licensed gun owner in Massachusetts. I mean, if you feel like you have to cross state lines with your firearm, which, again, is not legal unless you have a federal firearms permit or a permit in both states. A lot of people do that. A lot of people will try to get permits in states that they travel to a lot or that they work in or that they, you know, maybe they hunt in or whatever. But I guess he didn't have one for Massachusetts. And then you're going into a brewery and you're still carrying it on you. I don't know what what New Hampshire's laws are against having your firearm on you while you've been drinking, but I mean, technically you're not supposed to be intoxicated with a firearm on you, but you know, in my firearms instruction course, the instructor said, if you're drinking, don't have it on you. Doesn't matter how much you've had. Even if you're just saying, I'm just going in and have one beer. Don't have it on you because it just opens the door that if anything happens and something that can happen out of your control. If you go in and you have a beer with your concealed weapon on you and a bar fight breaks out that has nothing to do with you and the police come in and they question everybody and they find out that you are carrying a weapon on you and you've been imbibing alcohol, you can have your permit to carry, your license to carry, suspended. Not fair, but that's how it works, so why take the chance? This doesn't sound like he was in a situation where he thought he might end up needing to defend himself. Granted, you never know where that could happen, but I think this is one time that since you already brought it across state lines, you could have at least left it locked up in the car. I don't know why it discharged, but it, and you know, as the brewery owner said, no malicious intent, but that will be up for the jury to decide or the judge. Anyway, 508-996-0500. There was also another story that when I saw it this morning, I said, I'm going to make a mental note to bring that up. There's a situation where, let me just bring this story up here. If you do anything around the Taunton River, which keep in mind the Taunton River is not just in Taunton, that flows all the way down into Fall River. If you are someone who uses it for whatever, recreational boating, fishing, whatever you may do, you might want to avoid it for a little while. Because there was a raw sewage overflow. More than 2.5 million gallons of raw sewage making its way into the Taunton River. It happened on West Water Street in Taunton after the recent rain. Residents in the area are advised, this comes from ABC 6, residents are advised to avoid coming into contact with the river water for the next 48 hours while the overflow clears. I mean, 2.5 million gallons of raw sewage going into the Taunton River, and they're saying everything should be fine after 48 hours. You might want to wait a little bit longer. Now, that's different than what we talked about with the treatment plants and the shell fishing, if you remember the changes to the shell fishing, because that's wastewater that is treated from the plant. So that has already been processed. This is raw sewage. This is not processed. This is just raw sewage. The stuff that goes down your drain, making its way into the Taunton River. So you might want to think twice about doing anything on the river this weekend. 508-996-0500. Let's take a break here, and we'll be back in just a few moments. Be going into the newsroom with Ariel in a moment. When we come back on the other side of that, more with you, 508-996-0500. We'll also take your app chat messages and open line voicemails on the WBSM app. A reminder, too, we're about a little less than an hour away from getting your first win cash code of the day. It's going to be coming up for you in the 8 o'clock hour. If you've been listening, you've probably caught on when about to hear those codes, but it'll be happening in the 8 o'clock hour and then every hour through 5 p.m. So you get 10 codes each weekday to enter in at WBSM.com or the WBSM app to try to win cash. And again, you don't enter it in by sending it via app chat. You have to go to the win cash page and enter it into where the codes go, which is on the Win Cash page. So when you open up the app, there's a button in the middle of the screen that says Win Cash, a little circle there that you can, well, actually it's a money bag. You can click on that money bag. It'll bring you to the Win Cash page with all the code boxes for entry. Or if you go to WBSM.com, at the very top of the site, it says Win Cash. And then you can just click on that and it'll bring you over to the right page. So you don't want to send it via app chat. That's not going to work because we can't. That comes to us and we can't enter it for you. You have to be the one to enter it. But again, your first code coming up in the 8 o'clock hour. Right now, though, it is time to go into the news and get all of the headlines of the day from Ariel Dorsey.
Engineers set to restore the Francis Scott Key Bridge, a denied dismissal in Trump's documents case, and a sequel in the works for this classic film.
From the WBSM Newsroom, this is WBSM News.
U.S. policy on the war in Gaza will depend on Israel's ability to better protect civilians and humanitarian workers. That's what President Biden told Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu Thursday following Israeli airstrikes that killed 7 World Central KitchenAid workers earlier this week. National Security Council spokesman John Kirby said the U.S. is expecting Israel to soon present and implement concrete steps to protect civilians and allow more humanitarian aid to flow into the Gaza Strip. The U.S. Army Corps of Engineers is out with a tentative timeline for restoring safe navigation into and out of the Port of Baltimore after the catastrophic collapse of the Francis Scott Key Bridge. Engineers plan to reopen a permanent 700-foot-wide, 50-foot-deep federal navigation channel by the end of May so operations can return to normal. A federal judge is denying Donald Trump's request to dismiss his classified documents case. The former president claimed the case should be tossed because his possession of classified records was protected by the Presidential Records Act. The judge, in her decision, wrote the charges Trump was seeking to have dismissed don't rely on the statute. Officials are warning people about the possible traffic issues around the upcoming solar eclipse. The Federal Highway Administration estimates that up to 5 million people will be traveling to see the event. Officials say that's likely because there are 8 major cities within a 3-hour drive from the path of totality. It will cost basketball fans more to go to the women's Final Four than the men's this year. The cheapest available all-season ticket that includes tonight's women's Final Four games and Sunday's championship game in Cleveland is going for about $1,000. And another Adam Sandler co-star is confirming that a sequel is in the works for Happy Gilmore. Drew Barrymore broke the news in a preview clip for Friday's episode of her daytime talk show and said she'd gotten breaking news from her source who confirmed Happy Gilmore 2 is in process. Barrymore said she was inspired to ask about the project after actor Christopher McDonald, who played Gilmore's nemesis in the original 1996 comedy, said Sandler had showed him a script for the sequel.
WBSM Sports.
The Celtics beat the Thunders last night, and tonight they play the Sacramento Kings, that game at 7:30. The Red Sox will play the Los Angeles Angels tonight as well, and the Bruins will host the Florida Panthers tomorrow afternoon.
Now your ABC 6 South Coast forecast.
Happy Friday morning, everybody, with a temperature in the mid-30s, partly cloudy skies. Gusty winds up to 25 miles per hour this afternoon. Mostly cloudy skies, mid-40s. The wind very light out of the west, or just a tad breezy, up to 15 miles per hour. Overnight tonight, the clouds will continue to dominate upper 30s, a slight chance of rain. For tomorrow, clouds first part of the day, rain in the afternoon, mid-40s. Be sure to watch ABC 6 for my full 7-day forecast. From the ABC 6 Weather Center, I'm meteorologist Ceci Del Carmen on New Bedford's News Talk Station 1420 WBSM.
I'm Ariel Dorsey for WBSM News. Stay up to date with New Bedford's News Talk Station WBSM and get all of our content and breaking news alerts with the WBSM app.
Hanging around downtown by myself, and I had so much time to sit down and think about myself. And then there she was, like double cherry pie. Yeah, there she was, like disco superfly. I smell sex and candy hair. Who's that lounging chair? Who's that casting devious stares in my direction? Mama, this surely is a dream. Yeah, yeah, mama, this surely is a dream. Dig it.
And that is Marcy Playground, but Marcy Playground didn't make the list. However, nearly 50 other playgrounds made the list. Ariel has put together the 2024 Ultimate Playground List for the South Coast and for Rhode Island, and you can check that out now at WBSM.com and on the WBSM app. So this weekend, we're going to be dealing with, you know, there's going to be some rain Saturday afternoon. Sunday's supposed to be nice. Today is going to be pretty good. maybe you want to take the kids out to a playground and you're wondering, you know, what's around? Have there been any upgrades to some of them? Are there any new ones from the last time that you went out to a playground? Ariel's got the guide for you at WBSM.com and on the WBSM app. And we're going to keep that up there all through the spring and summer and into the fall so that you'll be able to check it out anytime. So you're looking for a place to bring the kids. You're not really sure. Some people, when we do this ultimate playground guide, some people like to make a little checklist for themselves and make sure that they visit everyone on the list. And if you want to do that, we've got the addresses for everything right there for you. Just type that into your GPS. But we also have a photo of each playground too. So when you see it, you can say, oh, wow. You know, we're not talking about, you know, a couple of swings and a slide here. We're talking about legitimate, kids will want to spend a couple hours there playgrounds. And as a lot of the older playgrounds are getting replaced, they're being updated, upgraded, because there's so many changes that have occurred in kids' playgrounds, from the materials that are used. You know, when I was a kid, when I was still going to playgrounds, I had siblings that were all younger than me. So I probably went to playgrounds when I was a little older than a kid that would normally go to a playground. You know, I was probably going there, you know, 12, 13, 14, because I had younger siblings that wanted to go. But that was the era when they were building all of these big wooden playgrounds. Lopes Field in Wareham was one of the best playgrounds in the area. In Randolph, they had the Randolph Playground, which was a fantastic playground. Had a zip line, all kinds of cool stuff. They built the one in Falmouth. There was so many big wooden playgrounds. Now they don't do that anymore. Now they've gotten away from that, and everything is more of a safer plastic because, first of all, kids aren't getting splinters on plastic playgrounds, but they also find they're more durable. Somebody can't come and break the wood off like they can with a wooden playground. They're less susceptible to vandalism. And if they do, it's easier to wash off. And you don't have the weather problems like, you know, if it's a rainy day and then the sun comes out, it's going to take a while for a wooden playground to dry out. But one of these, you know, new plastic playgrounds, they're ready to go in, you know, 20 minutes. It's like nothing ever happened. So there's a lot of changes just in the design, a lot of changes in the materials used. But then the other part of it is a lot of the newer playgrounds have a focus on being accessible. So as they're building, we've seen it happen in Dartmouth, a new playground, a refurbished playground, more accessible. Obviously, Noah's Place is the crown jewel of accessible playgrounds, but we're seeing more new designs incorporating that so that everybody has a place to play. So as we are, you know, going out there and collecting all of these and putting, you know, this list is out there, the Ultimate Playground Guide. If you happen to find something that didn't make our list, let us know about it. Send us an app chat message, or you can email me, Tim at WBSM.com, and I'll pass it on to Ariel, or you can email her and we'll update the list. Because we want to make sure that we have the Ultimate Playground Guide. And then as you're out there experiencing these playgrounds throughout the course of the spring and summer, send us photos, send us videos. You don't have to send us pictures of your children. You know, a lot of people aren't comfortable with that. But if you want to send us photos of the playgrounds themselves and just what the state of them are, send those on over. Playgrounds, to me, growing up as a kid, were exciting because when you went to one for the first time, you never knew what was going to be there. Is it going to have a suspension bridge? Is it going to have a zip line? Is it going to have the bars that you can kind of swing across? Is it going to have one of those like merry-go-round things where everybody sits on it and you spin it around, where I would famously make anybody sick. We'd all go, me and the four siblings, and my dad would say, all right, don't spin people till they get sick. And then they would say, spin me until I get sick, and I would do it. And then everybody would be throwing up the Slim Jims and Gatorade or whatever we had. But yes, we want to make sure that you can have the ultimate playground experience, which is why we put out the Ultimate Playground Guide at WBSM.com and on the WBSM app. And it's going to stay up there throughout the course of the season so that you can check it anytime. Caller, hang on. I'm going to take a quick break, and we'll be back in just a few moments. And let's go right back to the phones. Good morning. You're next on WBSM.
Hey, what's going on, Tim?
What's happening?
Not much. Talking about playgrounds, it brought me back a little bit. Remember the big toy? That's what I used to call it back in the day. I guess it was a brand name. It was called Big Toy. It was just literally what you were talking about. Basically, all plastic, all different apparatus, and it was just one huge structure with all different things, from monkey bars to like the rings to slides and all that stuff. It was just one big apparatus. And one thing that they're actually changing now also is the material underneath, so when you fall.
Right, yeah.
They're putting in rubber rather than, you know, 7 tons of wood chips that just deteriorate and just actually invite bugs.
Yep.
And just decompose, and you just always have to replace it. Now, when they replace it with rubber, like rubber nuggets, sometimes they even might even like chew up old tires. I don't know if that's environmentally sound or whatever, but I've seen them do that so that they, yeah, so you can just keep it for like 10 years, 20 years, and you never have to replace them.
There was one playground.
I kick them around.
I can't remember where it was. There was one playground that actually had crushed gravel, like really fine crushed gravel type pebbles, and you would jump off the swings, because every kid's going to jump off the swing, right? You don't stop and then get off. You jump off, and then you would land in this gravel. You'd have it like all in your hands and everything, and in your knees. Yep. And that's why the rubber is so much better, because when the kids land, it's a little bit, it absorbs the shock better.
Yeah, absolutely. And then when you go too high and you fall backwards, it doesn't hurt as much. And then also, I think, you know, obviously they got rid of the hot iron slide that was always nice to slide down in the hot summer day.
Right.
With your shorts on.
So many blistery burns. Yeah.
Oh, it was great. But back in the 80s, there was a ice cream shop in Westport. I think it's where the gravestone business is now on the left-hand side when you're heading into Westport. I don't know if you're familiar with that area.
No, I'm not too familiar.
So when you're headed into Westport, we're going into Westport. It's on the left-hand side. I guess it would be the eastbound side of Route 6. There's a tombstone business, and there used to be like an ice cream joint there, and there used to be that exact thing, like that merry-go-round that you would just spin as fast as you could and literally throw your friends off.
Yep.
And I remember that, and because me and my brother used to just run as fast. One would just grab one of the handles and run as fast as we could while the other one just tried to hang on for dear life.
The other thing I was famous for was the, the tire swing that would be hanging down, like in the, it would have like the pyramid shaped chain and then the tires sitting down there. I'd put anybody that wanted to on there, and I'd say, I guarantee you I'm going to make you sick. And then, oh, no, you can't make me sick. And every kid would get up and
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you get that. And then you have the, we'd actually twist the swing. We twist it so the chain twists.
Yep.
And then we would just spin them. Just let it go and just spin.
Yeah, I would sit in it and I would twist it around until I got it so tight that it was almost like pinching the top of my head, and then let it go and just spin around in a circle.
Yeah. There's a lot of good stuff out there now that's more accessible and more handicap friendly too. So you don't exclude everybody. Obviously, you don't want to exclude. So a lot more is accessible to a lot more kids.
Yeah, and they're able to do it without it, you know, impacting the play of other kids either. So, you know, you get the best of both worlds in these playgrounds.
Yeah, it's good stuff, Tim. All right, guys.
All right, thank you. Have a good weekend.
Have a good one. You too. Bye.
And playgrounds had to change, right? That's one thing that nobody looks back and says, oh, it was so much better back in my day. I mean, we can joke about how unsafe they were. We had when I was in first grade, when I started first grade, I was at the Stetson School in Randolph, which is now, I think, the police station or the town hall. But it was back then, it was the Stetson Elementary School. And we had a playground that had one of those metal slides like he was talking about. And it was kind of high. It was a pretty good climb, and it was a very steep slide, and the whole thing was super rickety. So when we would go outside for recess, they would tell us, you're not allowed on the slide. You can't go down the slide. It's not safe. You can't use it. And then my dad, because we only lived a couple blocks away, my dad brought us down there on a Saturday morning to go play on the playground, and he was like, how come you're not going on the slide? And I said, they won't let us use it during school. And he says, well, I don't see any rope on it or anything. And I was so he went up it and he went down and he said, that's fine. You can go on it. So I was like, oh my God, I felt like I was doing something wrong, you know, looking around like, 'cause my teacher isn't here, right? And went down the slide. And I did it a couple of times and got it out of my system, but it was still, you know, that's the kind of playground we had when I was a kid where they had to openly tell the kids, don't go on that. It's not safe. You imagine having that now. These days of liability and lawsuits, that wouldn't last a day like that before they would have somebody come in and take it down. But back then it was just, don't go on that. And of course, you know, teachers turn their backs and kids try to climb up it. I want to say that, you know, they tried to do everything they could to make sure that we were safe, but sometimes I question if that's true. 508-996-0500. You can also send app chat messages and open line voicemails on the WBSM app. It is a beautiful day out there, shaping up to be a really nice day. It's also a great day to grab yourself maybe a little picnic lunch, right? Maybe you want to go grab lunch somewhere where you can go and park the car down by the water or visit a park. Maybe have a lunch like crispy, crunchy chicken, which you can get at Gas Express Mini Mart inside of, well, at the corner of Belleville Road and Tarkin Hill Road in New Bedford. Belleville Avenue, rather, and Tarkin Hill Road. Crispy, crunchy chicken when you walk into Gas Express. And Gas Express itself is a great store. They've got lots of things in there. They've got lots of cool things and drinks and snacks that you won't find anywhere else. But when you walk into the store, straight ahead, you'll see crispy, crunchy chicken, where Victor and his crew are cooking up delicious chicken all day long. And they don't do a whole bunch ahead of time and then leave it under the warmer to get all dried out and gross. No, they do it in small batches so that when you come in and get it, it is fresh, it is crispy, it is crunchy, it is delicious. It's very meaty, but it's not greasy. Juicy, but not greasy. And you can get bone-in chicken, or you can get some of their boneless tenders, which I will tell you are the biggest tenders around. They are huge. When I tell you you can get a two-piece crunch box and that should be enough for you for lunch, I'm not kidding. They are that big. But you can get a two-, three-, or four-piece crunch box, and you get the chicken, whatever you want, boneless or bone-in. You get a side, things like their potato wedges, macaroni and cheese, jambalaya, beans and rice. You also get one of their delicious honey biscuits. These great little biscuits drizzled with honey. So good. Crispy, crunchy chicken inside Gas Express at the corner of Belleville Avenue and Tarkin Hill Road in New Bedford. Also available through GotChu, DoorDash, and Uber Eats. So try some today, and you'll realize why their motto is, if you don't know how good it is, you just haven't tried it. All right, I'm going to take my final break of this hour. We'll be right back. We have just a little bit of time here before we're going to go into the newsroom. We will get all of the major stories from ABC News, and then Ariel Dorsey has you with all the South Coast news from the WBSM newsroom, and then we can get your reaction to it on the other side. 508-996-0500 or using app chat or open line voicemails on the WBSM app. Coming up In the next hour, you will get your first Win Cash code of the day. And then later on this morning, you'll have more codes coming up with Chris McCarthy during South Coast Now. We'll have more codes for you with Brian Thomas filling in
for the ones who work hard to ensure their crew can always go the extra mile, and the ones who get in early so everyone can go home on time. There's Grainger, offering professional-grade supplies backed by product experts so you can quickly and easily find what you need. Plus, you can count on access to a committed team ready to go the extra mile for you. Call, clickgrainger.com, or just stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.